amazing how even a service like this goes to the future and our blessed hope and the reality of life as we experience it here and as we have experienced it in the past. And it's good to review what has been. It's also good to know where you are right now. And it's very important to know where you're heading. A number of individuals have sent some thoughts. Andrew Hass remembered that in Church Matters, Pete showed the mildness of a great sage and a gentle manner and warm engagement, whatever the context. Don Green said, Pete showed a Christian gentleness and kindness that made a deep impression on us. One who became a very good friend of Pete and Gail, Don Carson, had quite a bit to say, and I trust you'll read about it in your bulletin. But he said that Pete was loyal, praying, probing, humble, steady as a rock, praying some more, invariably able to see a gentle, funny side to things, proud as he can be of his family, and praying some more. I never heard him laugh uproariously. I often heard him chuckle. And then after his last visit with Pete, he said Pete was much diminished in physical strength, but not in faith, friendship, integrity, and his love of the Scriptures. Having been a pastor all my life, that would be the kind of Christian I would like to have a church full of. He did leave a clear example. One of my fond memories was Wilf and I went down to Florida. A lot of people had questions about going to Florida from here when we were still young to go to Bible school. It seemed like you're almost going to heaven to go to Bible school compared to not having as much sunshine as you'd like. After a year, both Wilf and I were planning to come back. He did come back. But during that year, God got a hold of my life. And so that summer, I was heading to Venezuela, South America, on a mission trip. So Pete flew down to Florida, and we spent a couple of days together. And then he drove back with Wilf home while I went on this adventure. But before we parted, I said two things. I said, don't tell Mom anything about my trip. I'll try to communicate once I get there, because I didn't really know too much about what I was getting into. The second thing I said is, I'm going to be going to Moody next year, and I need some money in order to start. I had run out of the money I had saved the 1 year I worked here before I went to Bible school. And so I talked to Pete and I said, you know, I've got my golf clubs at home. What I'd like to suggest is that you buy them from me and send a check to Moody so that I can start my Bible school at Moody Bible Institute. Well, back then you didn't have cell phones, you didn't have any of the technology that you do now. So I didn't hear from Pete at all summer long. I came back and I arrived at Moody with $15 in my pocket. And by the end of that week that I arrived, I was supposed to have my first semester paid for. And to make a long 5 or 6 days story into one final story, and that is the very, very last mailing I could get that week before the money was due. I got a letter, a note. Pete didn't write long letters. A note from Pete with a check for $350 for my golf clubs. I don't think they were worth that much. But I didn't tell him how much I needed. And he wrote out the check, not knowing that that was the exact amount I needed. The last mailing so that I could start my studies at Moody Bible Institute. He was tuned in, obviously, even more than I was, to the details that God wanted to implement so that I could continue in my studies. And it was an expression similar to what these others have noticed, the kids noticed, and the grandkids, representing that group of young people in the family. Pete was a generous, a gracious, a loving brother. I've often read the proverb which says, a friend that sticks closer than a brother. And though I, since I was 18, have only visited here, and he a few times came to visit us, whenever we were together, it was as though we hadn't been apart. We were very, very close. It was just a natural connection. And I've thought, a friend that sticks closer than a brother, I don't know of any other friend, unless it's Jesus. He does stick closer even than my brother, as great as he was. And that's true in the mind of Pete. Whenever we got together, since I was studying the Bible and preparing myself for ministry and then engaged in ministry, he always wanted to milk me for all he could for ideas, suggestions, evaluation, trying to figure out, tough theological issues. And he was getting a lot of help from guys like Don Carson, so I don't know how much input I really had that was beneficial, but it was great to interact with him. The Word of God became very important to him, as was already illustrated and expressed. As I thought about what to share, I thought I might as well take some thoughts from the two books of Peter. And so I read a couple of verses to start with earlier in the service in 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 15 and 16. But in your heart, set apart Christ as Lord. That's always the starting point. If you want your life to count, if you want your life to be full and meaningful, and if you want it to have direction that leads through the narrow gate onto the narrow path and ultimately gets you to glory, then you have to set apart Christ in your heart as Lord. You can express that in a lot of different ways. You have to be born again, you have to be converted, and so forth. But the bottom line is, you need to turn from yourself, your own abilities, your own efforts, anything and everything that you try to do to impress God or please God, if you want to put it in a more acceptable form, so that you get in. All of that effort is in vain. In fact, it's like a pile of filthy rags. The prophet said that in the Old Testament. Paul said it in the New Testament. It doesn't amount to anything worthwhile when it comes to eternity. The only one who can make it possible for me to have hope in the future is Jesus Christ, who showed his love by going all the way from heaven to this sin-sick world, living among men, being tempted in all points as we are, yet he was without sin. And as the sinless one, he could take upon himself my sin and the sin of the whole world, the Bible says, and make a payment that would satisfy the justice of God so that I, as a sinner, could find forgiveness and acceptance into the family of God and have that blessed hope established, which not only is for the future, but even here on earth, because it says, be ready to give an answer to every man that asks you a reason for the hope that is in you. It's a hope that's present. That's why we can celebrate the life of Pete. It's not just that we have hope that he is there, but we also have hope here on earth to go on ourselves. There will be a day when we will cross the Jordan, as they say, and graduate and celebrate and enter into that eternal state that Pete is enjoying now, which is far better than being down here. But it's on the basis of what Christ has done. And so the starting point, Pete says in his first epistle, is set apart Christ in your heart as Lord. And then it obviously implies that you cultivate that relationship so that you are always ready to give an answer. Now, when I read the reflections of Pete's life, it seemed early in the journey, he was struggling to identify what should I do with my life, my career, etc., etc. Now, there's nothing wrong with that. But while he was engaged in his work, he encountered people who had needs that he was beginning to feel he might have some answers to help them. And at first he sort of struggled. I don't know enough. I'm not sure I'm ready. And he put it off and struggled. And one time he felt he missed an opportunity. From our perspective, that might be true, but God is never put into that kind of a predicament where my faithfulness depends on what he can do. Even my failures, he can turn into that which is good. He is gracious and he is good and he is able. And Pete began to learn that lesson. And he encouraged himself, challenged himself to begin to be ready at all times. And he started buying up those opportunities. And what a blessing it was to me to read the account, because I walked through some of his struggles, job-wise, changes, uncertainties, and all of those things. All of us face those. Pete felt it very deeply. And to know that in the midst of all of those struggles and uncertainties, God was using him to touch lives for eternity, which is really what it's all about. You can gain the whole earth and the whole world and all of its wealth, and it amounts to nothing. And it's a sad contrast to having a relationship with Jesus that lasts for eternity. But when you share the hope that you have, you're to do it, Pete says, with gentleness and respect. And Pete naturally did that. I had to learn that. Because sometimes when you prepare yourself so well that you feel confident that you can do it, you get in the way. And Pete, in his humility, always felt as though he wasn't quite adequate, but he was willing to step out and do it anyway. And in that gentleness and respect for the other person, he was winsome. And there are those who are already in glory, and he's rejoicing with them, and those who are on their journey who have taken that step of faith. I love what Peter says in his second book. He says that he is a servant and an apostle of Jesus Christ. We know that. And then he goes on to say in verse 2, to those who through the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ have received a faith as precious as ours. Stop and reflect on that just a second. He's basically saying everyone who has trusted in the righteousness and the sacrifice of Christ, they have received a faith that is as precious as the faith that Peter the Apostle had. We sometimes put guys like Peter in a category all to themselves. Peter, James, John, Paul, those guys. Peter is basically saying anyone and everyone who has trusted in Jesus has received the same precious faith as Peter, James, John, Paul, and those giants of the faith experienced. Isn't that amazing how God puts us all in the same category? We're family. And he loves us all the same. I'm not going to go into the next 10 verses. I'd love to, but I'm going to respect the time element. But in verse 10, it says, therefore, after he explains what the Christian life is all about, what God has done for us, and I'd recommend that you read the first 11 verses of 2 Peter. He says, therefore, my brothers, be all the more eager to make your calling and election sure. In other words, he's saying, make sure that you're saved, that you're in a right relationship with God. And then he goes on to say, for if you do these things, you will never fall. That's security. And then he says something that Pete has experienced. He goes on to say, and you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. If you've established that relationship with Jesus, if you've trusted in him for your salvation, then you have security in life and a blessed hope in the future. Now, I'm going to do something. I'm going to read the next couple of verses because they're so characteristic of the way in which Pete operated. He must have gotten it from the Apostle Peter. Listen to it. So I will always remind you of these things. A lot of individuals have talked to me about the fact that Pete was pretty direct. He wanted to make sure that you were right. Pete says the same thing here. Even though you know them and are firmly established in them, which means that if he were to start talking to you and you were to respond and say, I already know that. You told me that before. You've told me 10 times. He says, I know, but he goes on to say, I think it is right to refresh your memory. You see, we are great forgetters of the truths that really matter. It's so easy to get sucked into the life flow of the world and get off focus. And so Peter, and he was getting very close to the end of his life here, says, I think it is right to refresh your memory as long as I live in the tent of this body, because I know that I will soon put it aside, and our Lord Jesus Christ has already made that clear to me, and I will make every effort, even while he's in the last moments of his life, I will make every effort to see that after my departure, you will always be able to remember these things. He says, I'm going to remind you, even though you already know them. I want to be sure that your memory is refreshed over and over again so that when I'm gone, you will never forget what I told you over and over and over again because it's that important. So in closing, let me just use the words of Peter. Make sure that you're saved. And when I say saved, I'm not just talking about sort of that fire insurance policy that you're going to heaven. I mean saved in the sense of setting Christ apart as Lord in your life. Turning your life over to him. Surrendering to him. Trusting in him. Following him. Asking him to enable you to be a light in the world, salt that has not lost its savor, making an impact for the glory of God. Now, I've been as direct as I've been because Pete specifically told me, I want you to preach the gospel at my funeral. So I'm simply following his instructions. So if you are a believer, rejoice in the blessed fulfillment of the promises for Pete. He's in glory, experiencing that rich reward, welcome. He's already experienced that. So if you're ready, that's what you've got to look forward to. Occupy until that happens. If you're here and have never made that decision, I would encourage you to follow the example of Pete, who one day, many years ago, established that relationship. And that made all the difference in the world. Not only through life, but when he faced death, he didn't have to fear. His last words, "I want to go home. I want to be with Jesus." Only faith can give you that kind of confidence as you face the reality of death. Because in Christ, the sting of death has been removed. And as Paul says, praise God, he's given us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to sing a song now. And during the singing of the song, I want to encourage you to think of what has been said here in testimony and in the Word. And then I'm going to pray at the conclusion of the service. And if there's anyone here who would want to be remembered in that prayer after we finish singing, I'm going to give a few moments for quiet reflection. I'm going to give you an opportunity to just stand and say, I want to have something settled in my heart today. I want to follow Pete's example. I want to be ready like he was. And I'll pray for you. If the memory of Pete and his testimony and what has been shared today has touched you, and God is calling you to either renew your commitment on a deeper level, or maybe there is someone here who has never trusted in Jesus and you want to take that step of faith, I'm going to ask you to just take a stand and I will pray specifically for you to respond and then for all of us as we conclude the service. We'll take just a moment in quietness. Is there anyone? Blessed Father, I thank you so much for your goodness to us. Undeserved, yet you love us and care for us and have made every provision necessary for us to trust in the Lord Jesus and find in him life, yea, life that is abundant and eternal. For this one who has stood, you know their particular heart cry, their desire. I pray that you might meet her heart in a very special way and fulfill her heart's desire and, even more importantly, your purpose and plan for her life. I pray your blessing upon her by the work of your Holy Spirit, in Jesus' name. And for all of us, Lord, as we have reflected on a life well lived, a long obedience in the same direction, a life that has touched many lives over the years, and now a life that is receiving, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." May each of us make every effort to make our calling and election sure, so that we will be welcomed into that rich eternal inheritance that you have promised through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Thank you for the memory of Pete, and thank you for the blessed hope that gives us assurance that all is well with him. And we who will miss him, we pray that you might so work in our hearts and lives that we indeed will experience the overflow of your blessing upon Pete's life as it touches us today and in the days to come. And now, Lord, I pray that you might bless and keep us. Make your face shine upon us. Be gracious to us. Lift up your countenance upon us and give us peace. We pray in Jesus' name with thanksgiving. Amen.